so much at Salisbury Church on this All Saints Sunday. We're glad that you're here with us this morning. We're going to start this morning as we have been our practice of late, and we're going to recite together this statement of purpose found under the word welcome at the top of your announcements page. To welcome all people, share Christ's love for one another, and help to make Christ visible. We hope that we can live into and live out, as I say, that statement in both what we do and what we say and how we live our lives, so that we might be examples and that we might strive to be better and strive to help others in the way that Jesus called us to do. Please pray for everyone on the prayer list that you see there. Pray for them today and pray for them in the coming days. We ask that you lift them up in prayer, because we know that prayer makes a difference. We're always looking for bulletin and flower sponsors. You can read that announcement if you're interested in doing that. Yoga meets on Mondays at 11 o'clock in the chapel right behind me. And we hope that that's something that interests you, that you will join them. Our journey through the Psalms continues. We did Psalm 27 this morning, and next week on Wednesday and Sunday we'll do Psalm 139. They're standalone classes, so if you'd like to join us, please do. Ladies Aid Society meets on Wednesdays from 10 to 3 in the chapel. You can read about the different things that they're doing to improve the kingdom of God and to help the church and to help others. And so take a look at that and see if you're interested in doing that. Handbell Choir is always looking for members, new members. You can read about the practice schedule and all those different things. And if you're interested or have more questions, please contact Tony Moyer and his phone number and email are listed there for you. An important day in the life of the church. We're kind of bringing this back. You all as a church used to do this maybe 10 years ago or so. On Thursday, November 14th, at 5:30 p.m., we're going to gather for a covered dish supper, followed at 6 p.m. by a planning time. Chart paper, committee members, chairpersons, other interested parties. We're going to plan out the regular and major events of the church year all the way out through the spring. And so bring your calendars, your schedules, your plans, and your ideas, and you can join with us as we make this sort of master calendar, if you will, that will take us through the end of 24 and into the year of 2025. We're always collecting for the food bank, your donation of non-perishable items, and there's a list there, can help others, so please bring your donations and put them in the bin over in the worship center over here to my right, your left. Please remember to cast your vote. It's a right and a privilege that you need to do, because we need you to vote. So that's the only thing I'm going to say about it, but please go vote on Tuesday. The Lehigh Mission District Christmas in-gathering is happening. There's only one card left for the small gift requests that we have that you can get after worship by seeing Robin or Lori. There's also accepting cash donations, so that they can go out and go shopping for other things that people need. This is a mission of a number of the churches in the area to make Christmas a little bit better and give practical things that help people continue with their lives, to keep warm, to keep from being hungry, and to groom themselves. So please pay attention to that, and if you can help, please do so. Finally, I know it doesn't seem possible, but because Halloween just happened, right? But if you could pay attention, and if you want to order a poinsettia that will beautify our sanctuary for Christmas Eve, please look at that light on the back of your bulletin. The deadline to order is November 24th, which is going to be here before we know it. Let us now prepare our hearts and minds to worship God. In the name of the Creator God, and of the Redeeming Son, and of the ever-present Spirit. Amen. no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us confess our sins in the presence of God and one another.
Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with all of our hearts. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and follow in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen.
Grace to follow your blessed saints in lives of faith and commitment, and to know the inexpressible joys you have prepared for those who love you, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Turn now to the Holy Scriptures. Our Psalter this day is found in Psalm 27. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When evildoers assail me, to devour my flesh, my adversaries and foes, they shall stumble and fall. Though an army encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war rise up against me, yet I will be confident. One thing I asked of the Lord, that will I seek after, to live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord, and to inquire in his temple. For he will hide me in his shelter in the day of trouble. He will conceal me under the cover of his tent. He will set me high on a rock. Now my head is lifted up above my enemies all around me, and I will offer in his tent sacrifices with shouts of joy. I will sing and make melody to the Lord. Hear, O Lord, when I cry aloud. Be gracious to me and answer me. Come, my heart says, seek his face. Your face, Lord, do I seek. Do not hide your face from me. Do not turn your servant away in anger. You who have been my help. Do not cast me off. Do not forsake me, O God, of my salvation. If my father and mother forsake me, the Lord will take me up. Teach me your way, O Lord, and lead me on a level path because of my enemies. Do not give me up to the will of my adversaries, for false witnesses have risen against me, and they are breathing out violence. I believe that I shall see the goodness the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord, be strong, and let your heart take courage. Wait for Our second reading is found in the 21st chapter of the book of Revelation. I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "See, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more. For the first things have passed away." And the one who was seated on the throne said, "See, I am making all things new." Also he said, "Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true." Then he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God."
The Holy Gospel this morning comes from the Gospel according to John, the 11th chapter, verses 32 to 44.
Glory to you, Lord.
When Mary came where Jesus was and saw him, she knelt at his feet and said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." But Jesus saw her weeping, the Jews who came with her also weeping. He was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. Jesus said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Lord, come and see." Jesus began to weep. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him?" But some of them said, "Could not he who..." Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the other sister, of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, already there is a stench because he has been dead 4 days. Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone, and Jesus looked upward and said, "Father, I thank you for having heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that they may believe that you sent me." When Jesus had said this, he cried with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out." The dead man came out, his hands and feet bound with strips of cloth, and his face wrapped in a cloth. Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
On this All Saints Sunday, we have this beautiful and challenging story in the Gospel lesson. The Gospel lesson from John 11 about Jesus raising Lazarus from the dead, his good friend Lazarus from the dead. The entire story about how Jesus arrived too late, according to his sister Mary. Mary told Jesus that if he had been there, her brother Lazarus would not have died. Then Jesus asked to see him. And they took Jesus to the tomb where Lazarus had been prepared, put in grave clothes, and then laid to rest in the tomb. By the way, as Jesus was going to the tomb, we're told, as they were going to Jesus' tomb, we're told that Jesus cried over the death of his friend Lazarus, a human emotion. Some who watched all this thought it was proof of how much Jesus loved Lazarus. Others continued to second-guess the whole scene and say, if Jesus had gotten here earlier, Lazarus would not have died, and others were probably questioning what was going on with the mysterious healing that Jesus was doing anyway. When they all got to the tomb, Jesus walked with the stone rolled away. Lazarus' sister Martha was concerned about the stench because after 4 days Lazarus had been in the tomb, there would have been an awful smell. Jesus quickly reminded Martha not to worry about all that and told her that if she believed, she would see the glory of God. Listen again to exactly what Jesus said. Jesus looked upward and said, "Father, I thank you for having heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, for the crowd standing there at the grave, at the open tomb. I've said this for the crowd standing here so that they may believe that you sent me." Then the text tells us that Jesus cried in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out." The dead man came out, his hands and feet bound with strips of cloth, and his face wrapped in cloth. Jesus said, "Unbind him and let him go." Many believe this raising of Lazarus brings a double message. I believe it too. First, this is a symbol and a preparation for those around Jesus, those close to Jesus, all of those, because Jesus knows that Jesus will soon be accused and tried and killed on a cross, preparing his friends for what might happen to Jesus very soon. In fact, this miracle by Jesus, this raising of Lazarus from after 4 days, contributes to those who felt threatened by Jesus and confused by his actions. So they report Jesus to the religious authorities and make accusations that this man, Jesus, was dangerous. The beginning of the end of Jesus, if you will. Additionally, this raising of Lazarus is for many, including me, a metaphor and a preparation showing us that Jesus himself will be raised from the dead. Now here comes why we read and encounter and proclaim this message today on All Saints Day. We remember and lift up the names of those that joined the great cloud of witnesses during this past year. Let's go to the part of the story that talks about grave clothes for a minute. If we think about it, grave clothes today in 2024 mean something very different than they did in Jesus' time. Today, when those we love die, we carefully choose something for them to wear. Sometimes it's church clothes, so-called, a nice dress, a suit and a tie. For others, it might be something from their life that symbolized their life, a jersey from a favorite sports team, for example. Now, these clothes go with the deceased to the grave. Family or professionals tenderly prepare and dressing the body in the last act of physical care for the earthly body. Back to Jesus' time. The body was prepared too. Instead of nice clothes, those trained to prepare the body wrapped it in strips of cloth, usually especially woven or specially purchased for burial, with a custom-made piece for the head and face. Let's look again at the gospel reading from John 11 and pay particular attention to the parts of the grave clothes. After Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out," Lazarus came out, his hands and feet were bound with strips of cloth and his face covered with a cloth. The burial clothes of Jesus' time. Then what did Jesus do? Jesus called for Lazarus to be unbound and freed from the constraints of the death. So here it is. The grave clothes become a clear metaphor that by calling for the removal of the grave clothes, Jesus is declaring Lazarus free. Lazarus free from his former life, free to live a new life in Christ. The second part and message of it all, Jesus is providing this view into the future of what will happen to him very soon, that Jesus will die, but Jesus too will rise again. Thanks be to God. Listen to Luke chapter 24, verse 12. This verse comes after Jesus' crucifixion, but before Jesus' resurrection. It says, "But the apostle Peter jumped to his feet and ran to the tomb. He stooped to look into the tomb and saw a few grave clothes." That's all. Luke walked away puzzled, shaking his head. Peter stopped to look in, stooped down, and saw a few grave clothes. The only thing left in the tomb were the grave clothes. The only thing left in the tomb was a pile of these fabric strips that bound the body. So after Jesus' crucifixion, death, and burial, the dawn comes. The dawn comes after the long Sabbath rest. The women go to the tomb, and they can not find Jesus. He's missing. After they tell the disciples that they can't find Jesus, the apostle Peter runs back to the tomb and finds the grave clothes abandoned, left behind in the dawn of this new day. No longer of use, a new day has come because Jesus is risen. Thanks be to God again. It's easy to turn those metaphors, those grave clothes, into metaphor. That's pretty easy to do. We do need to leave behind some portions of our own lives today, wherever we go. We need to find a resurrection and a renewal and a fresh start for life today too, don't we? We need to be careful that we don't jump too quickly, though, to the metaphor part of the grave clothes. We do not want to lose the power of the incarnation. You know what incarnation means? It means the power that Jesus came to earth and was like us, was a human being. In human form, the true presence of Emmanuel, God with us. We need to carefully remember that Jesus was born a tiny baby, just like you and me. Jesus was born to a young woman named Mary. Jesus grows through boyhood. Jesus learns in the synagogue. Jesus teaches in the synagogue. Jesus does and experiences all of the human things, like eating and growing and getting tired and giving up and resting and learning the power of physically touching and actually healing. Not a metaphor, an actual healing, because he touched. We cannot forget that. Jesus knows what it felt like to be accused and betrayed and convicted. As Jesus bleeds and is weakened, and then Jesus dies, Jesus, fully and utterly human, even as he is also God. These grave clothes matter because Jesus' humanity mattered. The experience of being human matters for Jesus. Why? Because our humanity matters. Our humanity, yours and mine. If we move too quickly to the metaphorical grave clothes, we can lose the hope-giving power of the real thing. Remember, that broken body, Jesus' broken body, was buried exactly like every other broken body. Grave clothes, shrouded and buried. Then human death is defeated. Human death is defeated by the God of life. All of this to say, on this All Saints Sunday, as we remember those who have gone before us in the past year, and we remember all of the saints who have gone before us for over all 283 years of Jerusalem Western Salisbury, and all of that time that they've been a light, a beacon, a witness to Christ here in this place, death no longer has the final word. And on this day of remembering our saints and all saints, that great cloud of witnesses, all of whom left behind their earthly grave clothes and now with their Lord, watching over you and me every day, thanks be to God. Missed and mourn still? Absolutely. But we also give thanks for their lives and their witness. And we also look hopefully to a time when we too are reunited with those we love. And we enter the joy and the perfect peace of everlasting life. Easter and resurrection are real. And we give thanks to God for the gift of God's Son, Jesus, our Savior and Lord, who forgives our sins and who grants us eternal life with all the saints.
Thank you. Jesus said, "Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the dominion of God. Blessed are you who weep now, for you will laugh. Blessed are you when people hate you and when they exclude you, revile you, and defame you on account of the human one." Jesus named the blessed ones. On this day of remembrance, let us recall and give thanks for those blessed ones who have gone before us.
Richard Dahl, November 10th, 2023.
Earl J. Kittline, November 13th, 2023.
John Burgraff, December 9th, 2023.
Dudley Stout, January 31st, 2024.
Esther Chabon, February 28th, 2024.
Elaine Treby, March 12th, 2024.
William Wadler, Jr., March 21st, 2024.
Helen Schaefer, March 23rd, 2024.
Greg Stecker, April 2nd, 2024.
Theodore Ewer, April 5th, 2024.
Scott Riker, April 9th, 2024.
Marilyn Slonecker, April 27th, 2024.
Robert Lawless, May 9th, 2024.
Sylvia Moyer, May 15th, 2024.
Dave Hittinger, May 15th, 2024.
Gloria Wyda, May 22nd, 2024.
Sherry Erb, July 21st, 2024.
Donald Atherbach, July 30th, 2024.
Gladys Ewart, September 25th, 2024.
Lynn Silfie, September 24th, 2024.
Loving God, we give you thanks for calling forth these loved ones. O God, keep them forever in your arms. May they stay forever in our hearts. Because of their living, teach us to live faithfully. Amen. Let us say what it is that we believe. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. And I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord,
who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead.
us pray. Loving, gracious, and ever-loving God, we give you thanks. We lift up these amazing names, these wonderful people. We remember their lives. We know and feel their presence among us from this great cloud of witnesses. We ask that you would comfort and hold close to you those who mourn this day. Love them in special ways. We ask that you would be with us, be with this congregation as it continues to move forward in new ways in serving you. We also ask, O God, that you would be with our country in this time of elections and some anxiousness and all of those things that go with it. Everyone safe. Give us a good outcome. And most of all, O God, may your will be done here on earth. We ask that you would be with all those who are in need of your healing this morning, this afternoon, and all day long and in the weeks and months to come. Give thanks for the gift of your Son, our Savior, the one who grants us eternal life. And we pray all of this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. Each week as we gather as God's people in this place, we take an offering. Why do we do that? Because we understand that everything we have belongs to God. And in order to show our gratitude, we give back a small portion, not just money, but our time, our talents, and all that we have been blessed with. And so at this time, we bring forth our tithes and our offerings. God be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to God.
Let us give thanks to God most high.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty God, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, by the witness of your saints. You show us the hope of our calling and strengthen us to run the race set before us, that we may delight in your mercy and rejoice with them in glory. And so, with all the saints, with the choirs of angels, and all the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Thank you.
Jew. There's no fence around this table. We welcome all at this Christ's table, where we are nourished to go out and serve the world. After supper that Jesus had with his disciples, he took bread a second time, and he blessed it, and he broke it, and he said, "This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in like manner, after supper, he took the cup, and he blessed it, and he poured it out. He said, "This is my blood, the new covenant, poured out for the remission of your sins." Each time you eat this bread and you drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. Christ has died. Christ is risen.
Christ will come again.
Let us pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying,
"Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread.
Forgive us our sins,
as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
chunks of rock.
I
Receive this table blessing, the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
Let us pray. Faithful God, you have spread before us a feast of rich food and drink in the body and blood of your Son. Now send us out to labor with you in service to the world you have made and among the people you have made your home in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
We stand for the city of our life and for all the saints.
Thank you.
other, to love each other, in the name of Jesus Christ. And as you go, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up the light of